Data transmission issues from your weather station can be divided into two categories. From the weather station to the IP100 or computer interface WLCOM software, or from the IP100 to RainWise.net, or the computer via the FTP program to the Climate Center computer. The first indication that you would be having a problem would be to log into your NEWA station page and look for the last download date, as shown here. If that doesn't match the current time, then you suspect that there will be a problem. Login further to the RainWise.net page will show that you have no radio signal. And if you have no radio signal, then you know that the problem is between the radio, or the weather station, and the IP100. If you're using the WLCOM software, check in the little box down at the bottom of the program, and that will tell you that there was a problem connecting to the weather station or that it's not receiving data. In either case, either the computer interface or the IP100 has a blinking light on it to show you that it is getting data. And if it's not, the red light is not blinking, then no data is being recorded. Data transmission issues from the weather station usually can be broken down into several categories. One, the battery. If the battery voltage is low, you will get no data. If there happens to be storms in the night, or during the day in the vicinity of the weather station, this can cause the weather station to lock up. Or obstacles to radio transmission. This could be something in like windows or trucks or something blocking the signal. The high gain antenna could be a possible cure for this problem. I gain antenna looks like this and can be purchased from RainWise. Now, data transmission issues from the IP100 or the computer interface FTP to RainWise or Climate Center entails the following. WLCOM to the FTP, there could be a problem with the program. You need to check that. In the case of the IP100, you need to check things such as the router, there could be internet outages, and there could be power outages. Looking at RainWise.net, you'll see in the status area of the window that shows offline. This lets you know that there's a problem with your internet between the computer, or between the IP100 and the RainWise server. If in WLCOM you see this and there's a problem in there, this area will let you know where the problem is. Now we'll have a question and answer session on data transmission issues with Richie Cohen from RainWise, adapted from a recent workshop.
So what we wanted to then do would be to talk a little bit about data transmission and data transmission issues.
Yep.
So the question on the floor from the back of the room was whether you could walk us through how data is transmitted. And let's focus on the IP100. Does everybody in the room have the IP100? Anybody here on the FTP? You guys all upgraded to IP100. I know that for Vermont. Are you guys all? Okay. All right. And you will either be IP100 or cellular data, Doug. So, and you guys are as well. So let's start with the IP100.
This is the same for all devices. Pretty much what happens In your weather station, this is for the long-range models. It operates and sends out a signal at 2.4 gigahertz, which is a pretty common wide spectrum band. And what it does is it sends out a 2.4 gigahertz frequency. And then your IP100 has a receiver for 2.4 gigahertz inside of it. It picks up the radio signal from your weather station. And then at that point, the processor inside the IP100 processes the signal, understands what it means, basically your data readings. And then it gives that information to an Ethernet module, which plugs into your internet. And then from that point, it sends the information through the internet to where it hits our server. Most of the communication from the IP100 to our server, 95% of you should never have an issue setting that up. Once you start talking a little more corporation-wise, firewall, stuff like that, there can be breaks in the communication there, which most of you probably aren't set up with networks like that. And
Richie, I'm just going to mention that some farms do have that type of thing going on because they may be fairly large businesses with multiple farms, packing houses, and different, retail, wholesale, etc. businesses associated. So they may have that type of thing, but usually those folks know enough that they have somebody that helps them with that, and they are able to set it up.
So yeah, and even with that, it's not really the size of the business. It's more so like if you're a bank where you have serious firewalls to prevent hackers and information being stolen, stuff like that. Basically, if you have a very high-end, top-notch security network that no one should ever be able to access, that's when you have issues.
So the data's on the RainWise Net server. So maybe, John, you and I can sort of take over the conversation because, Arthur, you wanted to know then how it gets to me. So it hits the RainWise Net server every 15 minutes. We need to have an upload rate of set to every 15 minutes. The data is scraped off of the web, off of RainWise Net, into the Climate Center database every 15 minutes. And then the data is presented to the NEWA website on the hour. So those the hourly data, what we call the raw data, is displayed for each hour. So you can imagine, for depending on what the sensor is reading, rainfall for instance, they have to accumulate those four readings to the total for the hour.
Did any of those four readings are missing, but then turns out to be
right. So the data that we present, we will extrapolate data up to 3 hours. If we're missing data for more than 3 hours, we'll pull in data from a sister station. So whether we extrapolate data or borrow data from a sister station that's designated near your weather station, that data is displayed in brown italics. So that you know it's not the actual data received by the station. So when you're looking at your data, your hourly data especially, if you're seeing brown italicized data, you know that there's a data transmission issue. There's been a hiccup. We've missed either one 15-minute reading, or we've missed more than that. And so that's essentially how NEWA works with the data. A lot of farmers want to be able to see their data every minute because that's like, I think, your maximum upload interval or the minimum upload interval is 1 minute.
Yeah, and Weather Underground would be every 3 seconds.
So basically, Wayne Burnett and RainWise are now working on some programming to allow you to set your data interval to 1 minute, but it will display and be ingested by us at the 15-minute point. So it's not going to disrupt our being able to get the data from you. But what it will do is it will allow you to set up more of the RainWise associated apps and other, sort of value added, if you want to call it that, products that RainWise is using. Yeah, so the question at this point, Richie, is if there are hiccups or missing data, talk to us about what types of things can disrupt the radio transmission at 2.4 gigahertz from the station to the IP100 where it logs the data to the internet.
There's one thing I'll say first, just because I get this confusion a lot. If you see offline on RainWise Net, that does not mean you have a signal issue. That means you're not hitting our server. But just get that in the beginning. If it says no radio signal, then you're talking a signal issue. And as far as signal issues go, this is, especially intermittent ones, is the hardest thing to track down, usually. A lot will help if you can have access to the weather station and catch it when it says no radio signal. The very first thing to do is, when it says no radio signal, open up the system and see if that red light is flashing. If it's not flashing, then there's a hardware issue for sure. Maybe 10 to 15% of the time with intermittent spotty signal, it's a hardware issue. Most of the time it's environmental though, especially on newer stations. Now, if you've had one that's 7 or 8 years old that has worked flawlessly in that same spot, it's probably going to be a hardware failure. But newer systems that you don't have a lot of experience with, things like heat-tempered windows. Say if you have a big porcelain tub in between the station and the IP100, mirrors, stone, concrete, brick, pretty much any solid surface, and if it's a very solid, smooth surface, that will really disrupt signal. Say if on your cell phone, when you walk into your house, you lose 2 bars of signal, you have a house that's pretty well good at blocking radio frequency. The best thing when you're getting intermittent is, it may take you a few days, but take a 24-hour period and move the IP100, we just lost some power. Move the IP100 around a little bit, see if your signal gets better. One thing you can do too, if you can't really monitor it all day, write down when you moved it, give me a call. I can go back through every minute of data your signal has received and see if the transmission quality is improved for you. Then another thing is the IP100 doesn't have to be plugged into the internet to receive signal. And it will log a day or two of data internally. So say you have it in your computer room and you have a lot of Wi-Fi routers and metal cabinets in there and stuff. Take it out to like your living room and plug it in and just look at the red flashing light. And if you walk by it a number of times throughout the day and it's always flashing, but in your computer room it's not, there's something about the computer room that's blocking signal. Sometimes raising the IP100 up or putting it lower to the ground will solve that. Another thing, surprisingly, a lot of people do, say their house is up on top of the hill, they'll put their weather station downhill from the house, and the signals don't travel uphill very well. So you want your station to be a higher elevation than the IP100. Usually, if you're about 1,000 feet out, you want to be about 10 feet higher. And then
how about the high gain?
Other things I've seen which a lot of intermittent communication I can help you with a lot, just because I can go through all your raw data, and I've gone through a lot of it, and I've kind of learned things to look out for. Sometimes people's signal is just strong enough to get to it, and when it rains, the extra moisture in the air is enough disturbance to break up that signal. So, I mean, if you look at it and you see, oh, wow, every time it rains, I lose signal. I must be right on the verge. Or every time the dew point matches the temperature and I have moisture building up on my exterior walls, you lose signal. Sometimes, I believe it was in Long Island, actually, we had one where the people were losing signal sporadically throughout the day. Come to find out, there's somebody parking a truck in between the weather station and the IP100 a couple times during the day. There's so much to look at. You really just, when you have signal issues, just really sit down and think about it. And think of anything that could be in the way causing issues, or, you know, we move this at this time every day and signal gets lost. Let's look further into that kind of thing.
So the question is, we have a ton of snow piled up on the ground. Can the snow itself cause issues while it's on the ground, or would it be an issue when it's falling through the sky?
Snow can actually be good and bad. A lot of times RF signals can bounce off of very smooth surfaces. We actually have a station here in Maine that's a 1 mile station that bounces a signal 7 miles across the ocean, just because the water kind of bounces it and lets it go back up and down. Snow can do the same thing. And then, of course, then if you have snow buildup, that's just, you know, the signal's coming this way and it's hitting a hill of snow, that may stop it. But if you got nice flat snow, it may bounce across the signal surface. Falling, that is putting more resistance in the air. Basically, you want to look at it molecularly. Every extra molecule that that signal has to go through is more interference it has to deal with. For the most part, if you have good quality signal, no weather event should really disrupt it. But if you're on the verge of weak signal, that's when weather situations can start interrupting it.
How about the high gain antenna?
The high gain antenna, same principle, only it's even better just because your typical weather station emits a signal at 360 degrees. The directional antenna takes all of that output power and focuses it into a 25 degree beam. So with the high gain, it can get its way through a lot more obstacles.
To kind of take a step back, you said that there's two different things, there's offline and no signal.
Yep.
So if it's offline, would they start with like the IP100, or just like resetting it? Or?
Typically, offline, the first thing you want to do is reboot your router. The IP100 is very finicky when it comes to anything changing. It does not like power glitches. It doesn't like your router being rebooted and giving it a new IP address. So usually, I'd say 80% of the time, the issue's in the router and the network just needs to be rebooted. If that doesn't take care of the issue, there's a master reset for the IP100, which you hold down the reset button, unplug the station, plug it back in, continue to hold it until all three lights go out, give it about, on your 15-minute interval, give it about 30 minutes, and it should be back on. If none of that takes care of an offline issue, or right from the get-go you have an offline issue, it could be you're working on a static network that you need to input static information. Sometimes I've had a lot of issues with HughesNet. Satellite internet is very slow and has a horrible latency time, and we've adjusted for this now, but originally the IP100 would say, you know, if the website I'm reporting to doesn't get back to me in 5 minutes, I'm just going to give up. And sometimes HughesNet takes 10 or 15 minutes for a response. But most of that's been reprogrammed now to where it shouldn't be an issue. Firewalls, the way the IP100 works is it requests to send information to one website over and over and over. And some, like a lot of bank firewalls and stuff, they see that as in, okay, something in our network is sending information to one place nonstop. So they think it could be a virus that's stealing information from the network and sending it to the host. Stuff like that could be a reason for offline, which really, if you get to that point, your best bet is to contact us, or if you have an IT guy or even your internet provider, they can usually help you walk through getting around stuff like that.
If that amber light is stuck on, what usually causes that?
Sometimes a little glitch in the internet connection, which usually a reboot of the IP100 will take care of that. If nothing does, it could be, I've seen one where they were running over a PoE system and they had a lightning strike and it fried the Ethernet module. So it can also be a hardware failure, but most of the time it's just a little glitch in the internet that the IP just needs to be rebooted.
When you say IP needs rebooting, is that the same as when you said a master reboot?
No, a standard reboot's just unplugging it and plugging it back in. Just like rebooting your TV, just turn it off and on. But the master reset wipes everything out of the IP100. It'll change all of your login passwords back to admin for the internal page, not your RainWise Net account, but it'll make it basically a brand new IP that will have to download new firmware and everything again, which it'll do that automatically on its own. Routine maintenance, you know, like cleaning the sensors and visually checking everything, a lot of damage can be prevented very early. As far as accuracy, though, it's not bad to send it in about every 2 years, and I can put, you know, the humidity sensor through, you know, 10% to 100% humidity, make sure it's reporting accurately, can check the calibration on the rain gauge, which you can also do that, too, with the rain gauge. But that will kind of, and for that, it's $150, and it's kind of just something we offer that, you know, it's coming here, we've checked it against our calibrated equipment, and it meets this. If you have any government requirements, we can do NIST certifications, which is actually government, federally official information to pass, you know, EPA regulations, stuff like that. Which I believe those are usually good for a year at a time.
You recommend that every 2 years?
Say again?
You recommend doing that every 2 years, sending them into you.
Yeah, it's not bad, that, and also I can recoat the circuit boards with new protection, just kind of beef everything back up again from what's worn away for 2 years.
Of the ones that you get back and recalibrate, just for general information, how far off are they? Or are they usually pretty close?
It's really all over the place. You know, I get a lot of things that have been in like the Isle of Man and Cancun where they get the ocean splashing them all day long. Those are usually horrible after about 2 years of salt spray. Some from Arizona. I've had some units that have been out there for 10 or 12 years. They're still spot on just because it's so dry. Really depends on the location and how much wear and tear the system went through.
A question about, the maintenance that you provide. You have a couple of stations that are very close to the water, and so the motherboards get crowded very quickly. What's the cost then that comes into that if those weather stations or if those motherboards have to be replaced with explosions?
A lot of the older motherboards I can repair pretty easily. The newer ones, I'm still kind of working on a way to repair them efficiently just because they have so much protective coating on them that it's almost impossible to even get to the components, which so far I really don't see those ones having an issue in corroding. And by the time corrosion actually gets to it, I mean, it might as well be in a flood and just would need to be replaced. But that the boards out there have only been there for 3 years, so I'm still kind of seeing the longevity of them. But like your older boards had a millimeter of coating on them, the new ones have almost a quarter inch. And you need a razor blade and a hammer to break into it.
The newer motherboard, the timeline is similar, it's like 2013?
Yeah, for what y'all are dealing with, yeah, pretty much 2013 and up is going to be the newest style system.
What kind of new things you got coming down the pipe?
Let's see. The biggest thing right now is repeaters. We do have a fully developed repeater. I have a few customers across the country and a couple in foreign countries that are going to be testing them out for me over the next month or so to kind of see how they hold up and how well they do. But that's something probably within the next 6 months should be available. I think the pricing on them is going to probably be $100 to $250 with, from what I know, two different powerful versions. One kind of a lower grade if you're just on a weak signal, and then there's going to be one with a much more powerful radio, kind of like the Yagi directional antenna, that will really bounce the signal further down. And
how are those set up? Does your station have to follow that same elevation rule or no?
Yeah, I mean, you still want the station to be a little higher. It pretty much is going to work. Do any of you have Wi-Fi repeaters? It will pretty much work like those. You know, if they're within range of the signal, you can put them on the outskirts of the main unit signal area, and then it will send out another bubble of a signal area. Basically with that, say your station's a mile and a half away and you can't really get the signal, you put the repeater 3/4 of a mile away from your house, and then your house should be in good signal quality.
Does that also work with obstructions? So you kind of go around the obstruction using your repeater?
Yeah, exactly. Say if you want the state, you have a big hill in between you and the station, you can put this kind of up on top of the hill where it's getting okay signal from the station, then it'll repeat it to the other side. Or, you know, if you have a metal grain house in between the two, you can put it on one side of the grain house to repeat around it.
Is it plug and pray or what?
Yeah, it should pretty much be plugged in and it should be functioning.
Okay, and do you see anything on that it's getting data or what?
I believe it has this flashing status light also.
Okay.
It was probably about 2 months ago that I put it through my see if I can kill it test. And since then I haven't seen it again, but so far I wasn't able to kill it, and I soaked it in water and everything. And, now I have a couple customers doing the actual duration test and getting stats and everything for it. But, say again.
If you need Long Island to help you with this computer as a guinea pig, well, we have a couple of sites.
Yeah. But should be available, I would think, within 6 months.
Is that directional? Like, you point in the direction, or is it like the original one?
Starting out, it's going to be a 360 degree. I imagine, though, once we get the first couple product lines out, we'll start doing directional ones also and giving more options for them.